Well, this is really a great pleasure to be here at the Cleveland Clinic and to be with you today and the audiences that will watch the videos of this session. And I want to warn you that today and this week we'll be shooting our next Discovery Channel documentary, and this is a documentary that will address patient safety. And I never thought in a million years, in the 80s or even the 90s or even the early 2000s, that I would be involved in making movies. But the issue is that we now know what we can do, we now know where we can focus, and it's really about engaging leaders, engaging consumers, and ground zero in the war on healthcare harm and improvement of quality is really in the boardroom, not at the bedside. And it really is going to depend on leaders like you to start to learn new tools of re-engineering care, and especially our physicians, and especially our nurses, and especially our pharmacists who understand the clinical processes, because we have to re-engineer our care. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna take you through a series of videotapes and other focused areas to meet the need that Mike had requested, which was to give you the perspective on patient safety 101, and not so much because you don't know about patient safety, but actually maybe help with some concepts that you can use as you embark on this re-engineering process and learn to use things that we've never learned in medical school or pharmacy school or nursing school, the power of stories, connecting the head and the heart to move the hands to action. This isn't really part of our skill set. And I always start this kind of a presentation talking about patients and families because coming from a technical background, radiation oncology and biomedical engineering, it was the last thing you did. But it's actually the first thing you do to engage people in the mission, which we really have to learn about. I use this graphic metaphor. It represents the 180 to 200,000 lives and I'll back this up just for a moment. This represents the 180,000 to maybe 250,000 lives that we lose in U.S. healthcare. And I use it as a metaphor because it helps us, and those are the faces of these people, to recognize that it is really about patients, it really is about the people, it is about the care that we deliver. And I think the best thing I can do is show you the trailer of the documentary that you'll be in from this meeting and a meeting last week at the Mayo Clinic with Dr. Steve Swenson, who was your keynote yesterday, and how we're telling the story, because it really addresses some of the fundamentals, or as Mike has really shared with us, the profound concept that it really is about the basics.
Well, what we've learned in the military over the years is that generally it's relatively easy to determine what were the causes of accidents that caused loss of life. And we very passionately try to determine what led to that accident. And then we write rules very specifically to keep that from ever happening again. And we refer to that as every rule in the military has been written in blood, and that somewhere along the line a mistake has been made that's cost somebody a life, and we don't want that mistake to ever happen again.
The house is on fire, you don't have time to sit around and debate about which exit to use. You're going to have to get off the status quo immediately and get your institution turned around to a whole new way of doing things, because it's out there, the methodologies are there, and the American public thinks we've already done it.
deaths occur each year in this country due to healthcare harm, making it the eighth leading cause of death. Now that's the equivalent of more than 10 747 jumbo jets full of Americans going down each and every week. And when you add infections into the mix that people get in hospitals, it doubles that number. That means that now 20 jumbo jets are going down a week, making healthcare harm the third leading cause of death in America. The overwhelming majority of healthcare harm is due to failure of the systems that support them. We don't have bad people, we have bad systems. Our support systems have just not caught up with the complexity of care. The good news is we can fix them.
I think administrators need to look outside their industries for good examples. We took a NASCAR pit crew chief to look at our operating room turnover. They're very focused on safety and efficiency, speed of turnaround, similar to our ORs. We brought them in with fresh eyes to look at our operating room procedures and turnover time, and got great suggestions and ideas and observations that we may not have seen.
Hospitals are dangerous places. We're learning a great deal from the airline industry and other industries that have used systems engineering to drive out human error and provide systems in place to back up we as humans as we provide the complex things that we do every day in healthcare.
There's been lots of crossover from industries like aviation and nuclear power. How would you feel if you're getting on an airplane and you look to the left and you saw that there were no instruments on the blank? You probably wouldn't feel very safe getting on that airplane. Well, that really is what it's like when a doctor sits down with a blank piece of paper in a hospital and writes an order for a drug or a test. We need to computerize ordering, and that can make things substantially safer.
I think we look at some of those new opportunities to move forward. Patients are getting more complex, another horizon we have to address. As you look at the increased complexity, we need to remember the basics. One of my themes always is stick with the basics.
The enemy that never sleeps, that can steal away the very lifeblood of our communities, are support system breakdowns that cause 95% of hospital accidents. We're treating sicker and sicker patients faster and faster with a more and more fragmented care team. We're not just pushing the envelope, we're operating clearly in the danger zone. Leaders in car racing and other high performance activities like flying jets, military aviation, the maritime industry, and nuclear powered submarines have a lot to teach us.
You know, just 50 years ago, we had a tremendous number of accidents in the aviation industry, military and commercial. And from studies of those accidents and the causal factors of those accidents, it's brought about change in the aviation industry.
Flying an airplane is safer than walking, but there's a reason for that. In aviation, you have a lot of things to back up human error or to catch it, and to have more of that same type of innovation in healthcare.
The epidemic of healthcare accidents is preventable, and ground zero in the war on healthcare harm is in the boardroom, not at the bedside.
This quality issue is never going to stop. When we found out how far quality has slipped in all of our hospitals today, we were shocked. As trustees, we have the responsibility to bring the resources to bear to bring this quality back to the level that it should be and that we all deserve.
Our hospital leaders owe it to our communities to learn from our greatest care institutions and from great innovators from other fields to prevent accidents and to protect our families from harm. These are our families. It's not just business, not just business as usual. It's personal.
The real sweet spot or safety envelope for high performance care is the intersection of three systems: leadership, safe practices, and technology. When these support systems are functioning within the right organizational culture, we get great care and we get safe care. America has the means to dramatically reduce preventable harm to almost zero. So my mission is to drive awareness. Awareness of both the harm and the opportunity to save countless lives.
It happens one little soul at a time.
So every time I see the end of that video clip, it chokes me up because that's my little boy. And the biggest challenge that we have is to fill this room. Where is everybody? You know, the issue is we're at one of the cathedrals of great care, and our clinicians and our administrators don't know who's really responsible for those invisible support systems that cause invisible deaths. Every Saturday morning or every other Saturday morning, I spend an hour to an hour and a half with my little boy trying to climb up in my lap as I talk to patients and families who have lost loved ones because of system failures. How do we tell our physicians it's not about their medical mistakes and that they have to defend their medical mistakes? Their medical mistakes are less than 5% of the harm that occurs. It's invisible systems that we don't have in healthcare, that we have in aviation, that we have in nuclear power, that we have in everything else. But our administrators, we only have 250 to 300 administrators that have any clinical training that are running our hospitals. So they think that we own quality as the physicians, and the physicians think that the administrators are owning those systems because I'm taking care of patients, and the busiest doctors are the best doctors, and the best doctors are the busiest doctors, and the busiest doctors don't have time to help. And so we've got a bunch of career committee people that are helping shape the measures and standards. When are we going to get our highest quality, our best talent on those committees to help shape the measures, standards, and practices? And the answer is, it's when organizations like the Cleveland Clinic, the Mayo Clinic, Vanderbilt, Duke, Harvard, realize that there is not leadership in Washington. If we have an 11% satisfaction with our congressmen and senators, I think we've all got agreement that we don't have governing going on. We have people that are getting reelected. And if we don't step up and make a difference and actually get in the game of systems, because that's the majority of the healthcare harm that occurs in America that is taxing our industry and ruining our industry. If we don't get into that game of re-engineering our healthcare, it will be re-engineered for us. And so I think that's my message, is a call to action. Now, I'm gonna use a couple stories to get our attention. I never thought in a million years that I would be making documentaries, but I was selected as a serial entrepreneur at Harvard to come with another 13 people who they picked around the world. One of the former health minister of Venezuela, the former health minister of Switzerland, the former chairman CEO of IBM, to come to Harvard to help them pull the silos together to focus on big social problems. And we had Discovery Channel come to see us. And I put my hand up and I said, I'm so doggone tired of doom and gloom stories on national TV and in the press that point the finger at doctors and hospitals and say how bad they are and leave everybody with this terrible feeling in their gut that it's hopeless and there are no innovators and nothing positive is going on. It may sell soap and it may sell advertising, but it sure as heck doesn't sell me on the belief that there are great organizations like the Cleveland Clinic and Mayo Clinic and others and great people at the front line doing great work. And I said, doggone it, I'm fed up with it. I put my hand up, I said, I want to know what I can do to get the positive stories on the Discovery Channel, thinking that maybe I can work with somebody who's going to make a documentary and that would be cool. And they said, well, you know, to really do that. And I said, we want scientific information that really people can use and motivate consumers and get in the boardroom and get our trustees, of which there are very few that are clinically trained, and those that are terrific, but they're a minority. How do we get them activated? And he said, well, you really need a celebrity if you were to try to do that, and you need compelling stories and enough science. I'm not sure you could do it. And I said, we're social entrepreneurs. That's why we're at Harvard. You know, you tell me what I need, and I'm going to go get it. And then within a month, assembled the funding, got Dennis Quaid, a good friend who's lost his, who lost an opportunity to see his children grow up, his kids were gonna die or they would be permanently disabled. And he has joined TMIT, our organization, and I got stories. And we went back to Discovery and we said, hey, we're here, let's go. And you know what? We ended up finishing number one out of 50. We had 3.2 million viewers. We now have three movies in the pipeline. We'll be doing one here at the Cleveland Clinic next. After we finish one that is more focused on technology with one of our other partners. So this toolbox actually evolved out of that, of the frustration of getting the message out about these system failures. I'm going to show you this trailer and tell you one quick story, and then I'm going to dive into this Safety 101. What are the principles? So we'll bring the lights down again for the second trailer.
Our little twins were the victims of preventable harm. They came very, very close to dying.
I have found out two shocking truths. First, the staggering magnitude of healthcare harm that occurs in our country. Second, how much of that harm is absolutely preventable.
And I asked him, Rex, are you all right? Are you in pain? Do you need something for pain? And he said, no, Dad, I'm fine. That's the last time I saw him alive.
Stories can unify the head and the heart and put our leaders' hands to work.
The WHO says to us, patients, you're important, and your voice, your collective wisdom, is important to the WHO. That's a powerful thing for us to hear.
Great leaders take risks. They confront their fear to drive adoption of best practices, and they invest in technologies that make it easier to be safe. Has this been done before? Do we have role models? Absolutely.
Technologies like barcode system, smart infusion pumps, electronic medical records, automated infection tracking, bedside barcoding, and CPOE all require investment in safe adoption, but they can have a huge impact on safety.
There is enough knowledge, there's enough energy, we have enough money in the system currently to do what we need to do.
Checklists help make things simple, predictable, standardized. They enhance communication, just like they do in airplanes.
How much does this cost?
Right, exactly.
It's the most important piece of equipment, really, on the airplane.
We got more involvement and more enthusiasm and more buoyancy in the pursuit of healthcare improvement than I had experienced in my entire career.
The reduction, prevention, and hopefully elimination of healthcare-associated infections is a prime focus.
Check a box, save a life.
The safe practices are a roadmap. There's no need for every hospital to reinvent the wheel.
So the National Quality Forum Safe Practices are a tremendous opportunity for all leaders now to unleash their full potential, to improve patient safety and healthcare quality, and it's time to act now.
Zero harm is the number, and now is the time. All the leading experts are teaching me this.
So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take the balance of my time. I'm going to share one more couple stories with you and then go through the fundamentals of the Safety 101 and the fact that we actually do know what we need to do. There are the assemblage and continue to be real-time assemblages of the evidence that is actually peer-reviewed, that is actually vetted. The National Quality Forum was represented by Helen Burstyn yesterday, an absolutely terrific leader at that organization. But the quality of what comes out of the National Quality Forum, where I co-chair the Safe Practices Program, is directly related to the committee members. It's directly related to the input from great organizations like this one and others across the country. So we do have a great roadmap, and we have a number of really good roadmaps and great people that are working on those things. However, it's about motivation. It's about awareness. And this beautiful child is Emily Jerry. Emily Jerry is a child who lost her life in this state. Emily Jerry lost her life because of systems failures. The real people involved with real systems in your state where these kinds of things happen, and they happen every day, and I see them every day coming in over the transom in the work that we're doing. In this particular case, there were a number of, just like any organization, that we're not going to talk about, and we never in our documentaries talk about the organizations. It's really, we don't have bad people or bad hospitals, we've got bad systems. And so this little girl passed away as a result of the same kinds of things that are occurring all over the country today. Busy people trying to do hard work, systems that break down, workflow that backs up, the predictable human error that occurs because we're human beings. And we know that if we're under stress, we make more errors. If we're fatigued, we make more errors. We know that if we're not trained about errors and harm, that those things can happen. And in this case, this child died of something that occurred in a pharmacy. And we don't have the systems either to support our caregivers, nor do we have the systems to support our organizations when these events occur. And in this particular case, the pharmacist actually went to jail, was criminalized, and there were no systems to help support that person or the family, or getting the family together with that caregiver at the same time. The healing that could have occurred, we don't have those systems in place. Now, who owns those systems? Administrators? Governance boards? Doctors? Nurses? We all own those systems. Those are performance gaps. And as we push the envelope in, what I talk about are the islands of greatness that occur in America. We have islands of greatness in a sea of risk. And as fragmentation, and you heard the clip from Dr. Henderson, complexity. We're treating sicker and sicker patients faster and faster with more and more complex treatments. And these islands of greatness are starting to replicate, and the depth of the sea of risk is deeper. How come everybody wants to come from Europe to train here at the Cleveland Clinic or the Mayo Clinic or our other great organizations, and they see that we're 37th in the world? They know we have a flawed system and system failures. But the great thing is I'm making this a call to action to you and to those that watch this videotape. This is a call to action for us to say, wait a minute, not only do I own the procedure and the operation, I actually own the episode of care. I actually own the trajectory of my patient. I actually should be involved in those systems. And I saw in some of the posters last night that that was the case. It's critical that we recognize that we're responsible for a lot more than our procedure and what we do in the exam room and what we do in the operating room and what we do in the interventional suite. Our caregivers are at risk. These systems that we have in aviation and nuclear power, we don't have in healthcare today. We don't have them, but we can take them and we can put them across. And then we have caregivers that are the second victim of these events. And I'm going to have you lower the lights again.
If I had a chance to make amends and talk with Mrs. Jerry, the first thing I would tell her is I am so deeply sorry that what has happened with Emily. I never intentionally planned or tried to hurt her daughter. I wish I was in her place. I wish I was gone and her daughter was here so that she could be enjoying her right now. I wish I never was rushed that day, now I was under the situation that I was at. I wish I could sit down with you and get to know your daughter, all the fun things that you did with her. I know she had a hard start in life, but I know you talked about the wonderful things that you can remember about her, and I wish I could remember those as well, because I'll never forget your daughter. She's in my heart and in my dreams. I'm really sorry. And I hope you can someday forgive me. Thanks.
So yesterday, that pharmacist who was subject to our criminal court system that went to prison for a systems issue that is predictable, absolutely predictable, and the father of that child, Emily Jerry, had a healing moment where they decided that the systems aren't there, but they can do something. And these two men had the courage to get together and relive this terrible event to move forward to help people like you and those across the nation, to let those stories actually move us to start to own these systems. And I want to acknowledge them and these two courageous men that have relived this and not moved on, but relived this so that they can do that for the rest of us, so that other pharmacists and nurses won't go to jail and other families won't have to go through this, or right here this morning. And I just like to acknowledge them. And Eric, thank you for your courage, for coming today and just standing up for doing the right thing and helping us understand those things and not holding bitterness in your heart and helping us with the story. And Chris, I know reliving this with your family is the same, and I just like the caregivers in this room to acknowledge these two courageous men for moving forward, because this is kind of leadership. So these guys have agreed to tell their stories, to write a paper together with us to accelerate that, and to be able to use those stories, but then to dig down and not use this as tokenism or symbology, but actually dig into the systems issues that our administrators and that our boards can understand. And I want to thank you for doing that. And now, so let's dig into some of those things. But this is leadership. It's a risk for a caregiver to go say, I want to know about the trajectory of my surgical patient and want to go farther. Rocks the boat. It may irritate people. But I have to tell you, this is the kind of leadership that we've got to have to fix the system. And I want to ask you this. If it's not the Cleveland Clinic or Steve Swinson at the Mayo Clinic and the great team there and the people at the Brigham at Harvard and the Harvard-affiliated hospitals and Vanderbilt and our great organizations that I have the honor to work with. And it's fun to work, get up early in the morning and to work together with these great organizations. For me, it's a joy. If it's not these organizations, who's going to do it? It's not going to happen in Washington. It's not going to happen anywhere else. It's going to happen because we've stepped up and say, wait a minute, these patients are counting on us. They trust us and we trust them. So when I got together with Dennis taught me a lot about storytelling. Who would have ever thought, as a radiation oncologist and a technology guy, that I would start to study storytelling? Turns out that I can get more movement in our hospitals and there are a number of articles that I'm going to show, and I'm going to go through a lot of material quickly. And all the articles, over 30 articles, the Journal of Patient Safety, which I'm now the editor-in-chief of, has given me the opportunity to give those articles away and give you the copyright for those articles. One of them is about the second victim, Julie Tao. Here is another story of another nurse. Again, system failure, a number of glitches in the system, well-meaning nurse with a track history of never having harmed a patient.
I've been a nurse for 15 years and had never made a med error. And then one day, communication failure, systems failure, human error, and extreme fatigue came together to take the life of my patient at my hands.
Well, of course, I believe as the chief nursing officer that I should meet with any nurse that has committed an error. And whatever, you know, looking at what committing an error is an important question. So I always bring a nurse in and ask a very important first question, which is, did you commit this error on purpose? And of course, people are pretty taken back by that question, but I think it's important for me to understand what was in this person's mind at the time that the error was committed. So, simple question, did you commit this error on purpose? When the nurse says no, I say, well, then it's my fault, because of course, errors stem from system flaws. And if I'm the leader of nursing practice, I'm the person responsible for creating safe systems.
So basically what we are doing in our documentaries and presentations is role models, and that's a role model. Do you think that's happening across America? Absolutely not. Maybe 1 in 1,000, maybe 1 in 100 organizations, but we can, and we have great role models like that. So my goal is really to address the performance gap that we have. Mike, you want me to kind of address what are the fundamentals so that we kind of can at least see those, and I want to address the invisible support systems that cause the invisible deaths. Invisible in that nobody in a 300-bed hospital with 15,000 admissions in the community understands what 200,000 deaths a year is in America. They don't know that that might be 2 deaths a week at their hospital. Then that's a wake-up call. And they don't see it in their own practice because these are high-impact, low-frequency events. They're low-frequency enough so that they don't happen enough for us to understand how big a problem it is. But it's the third leading cause of death in America. And then to address, okay, you know, it's great to talk about all these problems, but then what do we do? And we found the highest performers are operating in a performance envelope of leadership practices and systems. And that's what I'm going to, leadership practices, and technologies. So this is the performance gap. If you were to say, well, Chuck, how do you focus on re-engineering the care? The real issue is that we need to know what our is-state performance is. We also need to know what is idealized design? What in a perfect world? What's the safest that could possibly be out there? If we don't know that, we don't know then how to factor down where we are. 75-bed hospital can't do what the Cleveland Clinic does. A 300-bed hospital is different than a 75-bed hospital. An imaging center has a different set of circumstances. A 450-bed academic center has a different set. But then we need to look at the solutions that we can use to close those gaps. And then we have to have a very pragmatic, systematic, scientific approach to doing it, and not just throw ourselves at the problem. But the sweet spot is at that performance level. Now you're gonna hear me start to allow my optimism to creep into this, because I know we can beat this, and I know we've got terrific organizations that can do it. But I show this clip for the skeptics as my optimism starts to gravitate into this presentation.
Does everyone know what this is? Well, it's a lemming. From now on, we're not going to be lemmings. We're going to be leaders.
Yes.
So, Jim, what are we?
Leaders.
Yes. Nancy, what are we?
Leaders.
Yes. Ow.
So that's for the skeptics. I want to acknowledge that I'm a recovering optimist, but I'm on the wagon of reality. So what is our gap? I thought that this was pretty cool. I had the opportunity to take, I'm a political independent. I worked with the last four administrations, but I had the honor of taking Michelle Obama's place to talk to CEOs all over Europe a couple of months, two or three months ago, and we've opened a small office in Geneva. So I combined that and gave this presentation in Zurich. And here's how I opened. I said, you know, our U.S. News and World Report addressed our best practices. Just to give you, and what am I here doing talking to you about us when we're 37th in the world in quality? And I said, yes, we have islands of excellence in these great hospitals, but I think this cover of U.S. News and World Report tells it all. Our best hospitals are in it, but we're talking about taking too many drugs. You know, we write 1,000 prescriptions in America, only 600 get filled. Of the 600 that get filled, 300 people take them properly. They have adherence. The other 300 don't. And we used to call the term compliance is only 50%. And of the 600 prescriptions we write, 1 in 4 have an adverse drug event. Think we're doing well? No, we're not doing well. And people are starting to recognize it. The health insurance scams and a patient survival guide. Only in America could we have our best hospitals and the same issue with a patient survival guide going into a hospital. It really basically says it all. Well, so when I talk about the performance gaps, here's the problem. Yes, we've got safety programs. Yes, we know what to do. Yes, we're improving. But if your safety plan was written 3 years ago or 2 years ago or even a year ago, it didn't incorporate what we've known in the last 6 months. Our typical improvement trajectory is arithmetic, but our system failures that are causing harm, 95% of the harm are the system failures, not docs making mistakes or medical errors, are actually logarithmic in their expansion. So we are finding out, and we're treating sicker and sicker patients faster and faster with more and more complex illnesses. When you look at our aging population, 2/3 of the patients that are admitted in an American hospital this year, 2/3 of them admitted with a medical diagnosis will be dead or readmitted within a year. Is it any surprise that readmissions is a focus of CMS? Randomized prospective trial says that we can reduce them by 30%, that an expenditure of $50 at a discharge can save $412 to the system. Unfortunately, it's $412 to the payer, but we've got an exponential growth. Now, I prepared this for you in this audience because it's disproportionately physicians. So as we look at this and we look at the 101, this is our issue. True negligence is very, very, very small in American healthcare, but it gets lots of attention and it gets the media's attention. The support system failures are the biggest majority of issues, and they're invisible and we don't see them. And then clinical variability is above. So if your quality program and safety program is focused on clinical variability and the few outliers that are medically negligent, you're missing the majority of the system failures that are causing harm. And oh, by the way, that's got the attention of your payers. Your payers are now implementing punitive issues to focus on the system failures that most clinicians are completely unaware of and don't feel any ownership of. And then our non-clinical administrators think, well, quality is owned by the docs. So we all own it, nobody owns it, and they really are actionable. So the question is, are doctors ready to take the lead? And I'm seeing healthcare engineering and re-engineering really coming on now with our high performers. And I think we're gonna have dinosaurs being the old guys that only do their procedure and say, well, I'm not gonna worry about that. Because if you don't worry about the systems that support your patients, you're not gonna get paid. And if you don't get paid, that's where the no outcome, no income tsunami is hitting. So Mike had asked me to address hospital and healthcare safety 101. These three papers in the last 6 months are absolutely critical. The OIG report, the New England Journal of Medical article by Chris Landgren that looked at North Carolina's performance and safety systems, and the recent Health Affairs article by Dave Klassen. What do they have in common? They used the identical tool, which was the Global Trigger tool. I had the honor of getting to be involved in the team that developed that. Dave Klassen at Intermountain Healthcare was the one that started the Medication Management Global Trigger tool. I remember when we were drinking wine at an IHI meeting and he proposed the idea to two or three of us, hey, how about a Global Trigger tool? And we had the opportunity of working very closely with the folks involved in this. So what were the findings? Well, the findings of the OIG report, and by the way, if you want the full debriefing, go on our website, www.safetyleaders.org, and you could get the deep dive, the audio, and the transcript. But basically, what we found is 1 in 7 of our medical of our beneficiaries in Medicare are harmed. We have 15,000 seniors die per month. So if your slides, when you're talking about patient safety, say we have 100,000 deaths, you are a dinosaur, because CDC addressed 99,000 from hospital-acquired infections, and now we've got 180,000 number that overlaps those other two numbers of just seniors that are over 65. So the number's gotta be north of 250,000, which Lucian Leap and I have always thought is probably a gross underestimate. And yet everybody starts their patient safety talk with the 98,000. So 101, Mike, is the number's gotta be close to 250 to 300,000. And we're probably not even touching it. Now, how are we doing with our current safety programs in a progressive state? The same tool, the trigger tool, was used to examine that state. What did we find out? A longitudinal study using the identical tool with really good science that's published in the New England Journal of Medicine revealed what? No improvement. Does that mean we're not doing well? No, this exponential problem that we have is being countered by good safety, patient safety, progressive work, but we're still locked into a huge amount of healthcare harm, and that is going to nail us. Now, if you look across countries all over the world, a conservative estimate is 1 in 10 patients, and numerous studies have supported this. And Mike, we're publishing all the time now, and we're continuing to post those on safetyleaders.org. So, how did we get here? I like to use this graphic to or this video to express that.
Come take a trip in my airship. Come take a trip round the stars. Come take a sail around.
100 years ago, the Wright brothers had the inspiration to make a brilliant idea take flight.
Come take a trip in my airship. Come take a trip round the stars.
So I'm really privileged to have the team. You'll see Matt Listiak over here on the side, our producer. I think we've got the best medical multimedia team in the world. The people at these major multinational companies count on us to help them. And I test video and test messages all the time. This has been my single, I've been using this for almost 10 years. This is my single most powerful tool, this video clip, which we'll make available to you all in the boardroom. Because they always say, well, we got the best doctors. We can't possibly have the problem. Well, that's like the engine, the jet engine that's strapped onto the Kitty Hawk aircraft. We've got the best doctors. We've got the best software. We've got the best technology. We've got these procedural excellence. But it's operating on top of 15 to 20-year-old to 25 to 30-year-old support systems. Why? Because our reimbursement system doesn't have a reimbursement code for investment, and our administrators that are non-clinically, typically, not in this organization and others around the country that are high performers, don't understand the importance of investing in those support systems. So I use this story to say, yes, we can have the best docs and the best software and the best technology and winning the medical arms race and still have colossal healthcare harm as we look out over the trajectories of our patients, because the systems that support them are so old. Second issue, safety 101. What's the issue? What's the second issue? Well, we've got two processes at play, and that is migration of boundaries and normalization of deviance. This is a normal process where if we're driving at 55 on the highway in California and it's a blue sky and it's a dry day, we're safe and legal. But the speeds creep up, and towards the end of the day, you're running 75, 80 miles an hour, the pack's moving and everything is going great. What happens if you have a little mist in the rain? Now night falls. Now we have twilight, one of the most dangerous times because of light. Well, we've got the boundaries are migrated, but we have normalized the deviance of operating at 75 or 80 miles an hour. Stopping distances have changed. Our visual perception has changed. A number of things have changed. So the single thing that I see across America, the two most important issues that are tied to the single most important issue are the invisible systems. We've got systems that we haven't invested in, and we've allowed financial pressures, increased volume, production, and a number of factors that we didn't really realize cause us to migrate the boundaries of the performance that we're delivering. The typical nurse in America goes to the medication cabinet 100 times in a typical shift, 200 times by a nursing station, walks 3 to 5 miles a day, and is 3 times more prone to having an accident at the end of the day. Average age is 49. The average age of a teaching nurse is 53. They now got some visual changes that we all have with age. I've got them, the hearing difficulties, and you overlay that with increasing demands of using technology, and then you've got financial pressures, and then what do we do with our best nurses? This is what we do with them.
Speed it up a little!
So this would be funny, but it's not funny to Eric, is it? You can relate to that, can't you? And the people that you now talk to when you go around the country and talk about this, this is what you're seeing. This is natural, it's a natural phenomenon, but we as clinicians have got to step into the boardroom and start talking about the support systems investments that are critical. It's not just getting that new technology or that new thing that we want for a procedure, it's the support systems that are critical. And only the clinicians that really understand the clinical impact of some of these issues can be the ones to make that message. So, Mike, that's the call to action on 101, is to say it's really now time to do that. And it's also about our behavior as physicians. The leaders of the quality movement tell us that communication is a major component of almost every serious system failure. The following clip captures the essence of some of the challenges we face.
Watch out!
Girl?
Yes, sir.
I want you to do something very important, all right?
Okay.
I want you to run home, and I want you to call the ER of North Bank General Hospital, 932-1000. Tell them to set up OR6 immediately and contact anesthesiologist Isadora Turek, 472-2112, beep 12. Have them send an ambulance with a paramedic crew, light IV, D5 and W, KBO. You got it?
ER, North Bank General Hospital, 932-1000, set OR6 contact. Anesthesiologist Isadora Turek, 472-2112, beep 12. Ambulance with paramedics and light IV, D5 and WKVO.
That's good.
Sounds like a subdural hematoma to me.
Oh, it does it? Well, it's not your job to diagnose.
But I thought...
You thought, just go! 3 years of nursery school and you think you know it all, but you're still wet behind the ears. It's not a subdural hematoma, it's epidural. Ha!
So that's so rich with teaching moments, and I show that at almost every presentation. You know why? Because this communication issue between caregivers continues to be one of our most plaguing problems in the Safety 101 issue. And I see you nodding again, Eric, that you see that. So the communication, the systems, how we handle information, and I haven't really even talked about individual procedural issues. But there's also the elephant in the room, and the elephant in the room is dollars. And one of the reasons we're here is that we have really gone through the cycles. And Jim Collins is a good friend, and he wrote the book, How the Mighty Fall. And he said the downfall of many great companies and the fall of the mighty is stage one, hubris born of success, undisciplined pursuit of more, and denial of risk. And what is read here, most of our frontline hospitals are in stage two or stage three. Read the book, terrific book, fast read, makes sense. You will see it. Most of them are there. This unmitigated pursuit of more. At Harvard Business School, and I have the honor of being able to attend and participate with the business school, the medical school, and work with these wonderful leaders. And at the business school, the favorite game of MBAs at Harvard Business School, what's your number? What is the number of dollars that you would need so you wouldn't have to do what you're going to have to do to get rich?
Mm-hmm.
What's your number?
Sorry?
Your number. The amount of money you would need to just walk away from it and live. See, I find that everybody has a number, and it's usually an exact number. So what is yours?
More.
And that's what I find across America. And I'm an entrepreneur. I get it. I get it. But what is our number of cases that we're going to want to attain before we can take 10 to 20% of our time to help with systems? What is the number that an organization needs to get in terms of facilities it buys or volume or production when they're going to stop and invest in the systems to prevent the death of Emily Jerry, the next Emily Jerry? You know, how much is it going to be? And the answer is, unless we have great leadership from our clinical leaders in America, I just don't think it's going to happen. We've been talking to CEOs for years and years and years and years, but really, once we get clinical people in the boardroom, the ground zero in healthcare harm is not at the bedside, it's in the boardroom, and you need to be equipped to do that. Our healthcare story, the crisis is hospital accidents. The victims are not only patients, but they're the caregivers. The villains are support systems. They're not bad doctors or bad people. The systems have evolved that way, but the heroes are going to be the folks that actually step into the boardroom. So performance envelopes, you saw the Dennis Quaid story. It's at the sweet spot of engaged leaders, practices, and technology. Why? Because technology can't do it alone. I've learned that in the 80s to the early 90s. That's why I'm here. That's why I had the economic capability to do this and to be involved in these national systems with you, Mike, and others. The performance gaps cannot be closed by technology alone. Clinical, operational, and financial performance are interlocked and tightly coupled. As we look at our technologies, clinicians need to be involved in the selection of the solutions that they're involved in because they impact clinical performance, but they've got to go beyond into the financial. And we need to know the cost of treatment and the cost of harm. So what happened was I started to focus on practices, realized that technologies couldn't do it alone in patient safety and quality. And that's where we started to focus on safe practices. And we broke new barriers and had more impact and greater impact on the system performance. We were able to harmonize across these organizations, the certifying, quality, and purchasing organizations. But you know what? It wasn't enough. We realized that probably the most important practice that we had was a leadership practice, which was tying the system performance, clinical ops, and finance in the boardroom and tie that to governance and leadership. And that's why the most important safe practice in the set is safe practice one. So that's where the sweet spot is, in the sweet spot of that intersection. So the practical advice that I could give you is you improve safety and quality in your organization or in your microsystem of cardiothoracic surgery or radiology or interventional radiology is engagement of your leaders, focus on the systems, focus on the practice, and then look at it. I'll conclude, and I still have a few more minutes, about 5 to 10 after. Okay, so we wrote an article, The No Outcome, No Income Tsunami, Are You a Surfer, Swimmer, or Sinker? And this was to engage leaders because this No Outcome, No Income Tsunami is really going to be focused on dramatic change in behavior, but the behavior is not clinical behavior. It really is leadership behavior. It's broadening our horizons to healthcare engineering. It's communications. It's understanding the numbers. It's being able to kind of analyze the trajectories of your patients. This is Bill George, one of our leaders, and I recommend the book True North and Authentic Leadership. He got a standing ovation at Harvard Business School when I was there for a whole week when he really drew from, and a lot of financially driven folks, he drew on their core values. Clay Christensen has written The Innovator's Prescription. I've got video clips you'll see on our website, and he will be in our documentary. Clay came back from heart disease. He had a heart attack, stroke, cancer, detached retina in the last 3 years. He had to learn to speak again, and he's focused on healthcare. I'm just going to move forward to kind of finish up here on time. But the one thing that we've been doing for this documentary is we're going around America and we're focusing on the greatest leadership systems because you know what? They don't exist in healthcare. They really don't. We haven't learned about how to develop high performance teams. We've just scratched the surface with checklists from aviation. We scratched the surface with Six Sigma and with the Toyota Lean approach. Just scratched the surface. This is a company that does has $1.1 billion in revenue, 65 global locations, and what do they focus on? The personal fulfillment of each of their employees. And they don't worry about the customer anymore. They know if they fulfill you at your job, doing great work, using Toyota Lean, using really good business principles, that everything takes care of itself. And as we videotape them, we've seen phenomenal issues. Sully Sullenberger is a good friend, and the video clip, at the end of that clip, the reason I get choked up when I see my little boy there, and Dennis says, we do it, we win it one little soul at a time. That audio was taken from a meeting we had putting together the strategy for an NTSB for healthcare. Sully Sullenberger was there, and Dennis and I asked Sully, what did you learn from your event? And I was with him a couple weeks ago in Boston with some of our leaders of patient safety, and this is what Sully said. And I'll show you the clip to just remind you of that amazing landing.
The three things that I did particularly well, even though we hadn't been trained for this eventuality, was I first, in spite of my normal human physiological reaction to the stress, I forced calm on myself. Just a professional calm, a practiced calm that we as professional pilots learn how to summon up from somewhere within us. Even as I could feel as it was happening, my body's natural reaction to this event, I realized immediately the severity of it, and so I could feel my pulse and my blood pressure spike. I could sense my visual field narrow due to the stress. But I was able to compartmentalize, and I was able to discipline myself to force myself to focus on the task at hand. The second thing I did was that I was able to impose order on what conceivably could have been chaos. I imposed my paradigm based upon my training on this unanticipated situation so that it became a problem that I therefore knew how to solve. And finally, I knew that since the workload was so extreme and the time compression beyond extreme, that I wouldn't have time to do everything I needed to do. So instead, I chose to do a few things extraordinarily well, the most important things very well, the things that really mattered very well. And then I actively, ruthlessly ignored as mere distractions everything else.
So what I'm going to do to close is address the issue of the care reengineering. What we're doing with Cleveland Clinic, with the Mayo Clinic, with the Brigham, with Frontline Hospitals and Ascension Health and Catholic Healthcare Partners is a program called Greenlight. You know, we focused the first decade on technology transfer to really drive down the risk and the error and the harm, and we are staying with that. CPOE, barcode, a number of the technologies that are critical. And we then began focusing on coupling that with the practices, focusing on safe practices. So the NQF Safe Practices for Better Healthcare 2010 will be updated for this next year, but you can download it from the National Quality Forum and you can look at it on our website. And that was the second piece. So you can't ignore the technologies, but we can't focus on technologies alone. Coupling them with safe practices that deliver predictable outcomes against solid evidence-based medicine with consensus-developed specifications is the roadmap that really gives us the recipe, which I'm not going to cover today, because it really is about leadership. And the third thing is that engaged leaders can now have these roadmaps that they can use. There are over 600 measures and standards and practices at the NQF. As we get engaged in those measures and standards and then use the technologies to accelerate them, the only way we can do that is by engaged leaders at the boardroom and really focus on that. So our Greenlight program, what we realized was we had to make the financial case to CFOs and chief operating officers and administrators for investment in safety. Our preliminary findings reveal things like this, that you have to treat 67 patients without harming them. Preventable harm, you have to treat 67 patients to pay for one harmed patient. That's only one slide. That opens the discussion with the CFO and the COO. Why did we name it Greenlight? Because in the movie business, a go movie means that you've got the green light. The concept is, if you can work with your finance and operations people and get the green light for investment in patient safety, making a change, investing in new systems, investing in working with nurses, sending people offsite to another location, and you can develop the ROI and take that back to your CFO and chief operating officer before you pitch it to the CEO, before you go in the boardroom, you get the green light vote. And so what we're doing is we're building impact calculators and giving them away so that we can help clinicians make that financial business case that then can tie to the clinical processes and care processes that then can be tied to the technologies. So I think the Safety 101, and I'm done, Safety 101 focus really is clinical, operational, financial performance. What we've got to do is have engaged leaders, focus on safe practices. They are in the literature. You don't have to go do literature searches. There are roadmaps now that we could use. And then use the technologies that enable them. And don't start with the technologies. Start with the best practices of your best engaged leaders. Get your best clinical people involved. Free them up so that you don't get career committee members that are creating the measures and the standards or the care processes. Because those people don't know where the action is. Thank you very much.